Thank you. Good evening. I welcome all the students and also I welcome Sarina, today's speaker. And also I also welcome all the staff and our coordinator, Darshana ma'am, who's also taken time out of a busy schedule so that she can be, with us in this first webinar after the corona time. So yes, I do welcome Vinaya ma'am to go ahead and introduce my friend, my senior, my elder sister from Bangalore. Vinaya ma'am, over to you.
Thank you, sir. My job is to introduce Sharanya ma'am. Let me do it. So Sharanya Francis is a multilingual poet, English lecturer, life skills trainer, faculty facilitator, women empowerment activist, and educationalist. She has to her credit three published anthologies of poetry titled Being Purple, Ambidu, and Sonder. As a teacher facilitator, Sharanya has trained several batches of teachers at Code Schools, Hyderabad, under the banner of ReGuru, a teacher training initiative by SAF Foundation. She has also trained principals and staff of Karnataka Residential Educational Institutions, Institution Society, in language teaching techniques and classroom management. Her training skills have also benefited women's self-help groups and across the country in setting up SHGs. She has been a trainer with Igniters, a training initiative of the Bangalore Jesuit Educational Society, since 2010. She edited Andhagada, co-edited Confluence 1 and 2. Sharanya is the curator of the monthly poetry open mic of Bangalore Poetry Circle. Her poems are published in several esteemed anthologies across the globe, such as This Time Literary Canada, Limca Book of Records imprint, Amravati Poetic Prison India, and Pan Indian Poetry in English spanning first two decades of 21st century. Apart from poetry, she has assisted the establishment of Kosh cells in organizations, women's self-help groups, entrepreneurial ventures for women in need, and driven campaigns for child rights while representing the nation as a youth activist in conferences in Rome, Bangladesh, and Canada. Sharanya Francis is currently an assistant professor of English at St. Paul's College, Bangalore, and the secretary of SAF Foundation. An accomplished poet, Sharanya is the recipient of Star Ambassador of World Poetry 2019, Bharat Award for Literature 2018, and Rabindranath Tagore Award of Poetry 2017. Thank you. Welcome to the program.
Sharanya ma'am, over to you. So you have my eyes, students and teachers.
I hope I'm audible to all of you.
Yes, and I'll just give you the host so that you can share the presentation. Thank you.
All right, so there was a lot of, there were a lot of details in that profile that Ms. Vinaya read out in such a prolific voice. You've got a great voice, Vinaya. Thank you for that. So,
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, so it's wonderful for me to be here this afternoon because speaking about poetry is not something that a lot of people encourage. And I'm so glad that Professor Nidhin has taken up this course for your college and is very pertinent that he persistent that his students should get a feel and flavor of poetry. So kudos to you on that, Professor Nidhin, because I think we need a lot of people to support the course of poetry, without which it would probably fail miserably. So thank you so much on that choice.
And thank you, ma'am.
In fact, I was going through the details about Fatima College. I've heard of it from friends and fellow poets. So for me, it is it was wonderful to be invited to talk to your students. So when I was going through, I understand that you have a legacy of over 55 years. And I'm sorry, you must be talking 75 years now, 70 years now. So in these 70 years, there seems to be a journey of...
Saranyam, I think the voice is getting muffled again. The audio is getting muffled again.
Yeah. From my end, it is fine.
Now it's clear. Now it's clear. Okay. I think because of the reception. Okay. Thank you.
So, like I was saying, I went to the legacy of the college and so happy to be a part of anything that's happening out there. All right. So before we begin, I'd like to check if everybody is prepared for the session this afternoon, the students especially. I hope you have a pen and paper around you because I generally tend to get my participants to do a lot of writing and some scribbling. So I hope you've got pen and paper ready. If not, then I'll give you like a minute to grab your pen and pencil and a paper. Can you do that for me quickly? Don't worry, I'm not going to ask you to write an essay about what you think about poetry or who do you think is the favorite poet and write it. No, I'm not going to do any of that. Okay, we're going to do some fun activities and I want you all to be a part of it. That's it. Okay, quickly grab a pen and pencil for me. You all can, great. Okay, so let's begin without delaying this too much. Okay. So this is what I was asked to speak on, when Professor Nivin asked me to talk at your college. He said, I want you to talk about the journey of the poet. And I also wanted to tell my students what kind of a treasure poetry is. So I don't know if I would be able to do justice to that in its entirety, but as a published poet, as a poet who has been through this journey of words and afterwards, I can tell you that it's an incredible, incredible experience, right? It's my belief that everyone writes a poem. Okay, so to begin with, I always begin my sessions as an artist, especially with this statement. And I strongly suggest that anybody who is, who wants to take up art, a particular art as a full-time pursuit, do this as well. So this is my artist statement, and I generally begin with this artist statement. I am a narrator. My radical personal truth is what I create needs to be heard. I am a woman of discretion, a woman who holds tales that contain the deepest halls of self and other women who have submitted their stories to my memory. I may be a work in progress, but the journey to progress is my history. I move from being a wide-eyed spectator to a discerning minstrel, charismatic and full of critical chronology context, omitted by those with an agenda to silence my voice, and thereby the voice of others. The reason I read out this artist statement is because I want young people to understand, especially young people who are trying to engage with poetry, that it is so important to acknowledge where your art is coming from, where your voice is coming from. It's very important that you understand why you write. Okay? If you understand why you write, then how to write becomes a very easy thing. Okay? So I always insist that young artists have this direction, have this clarity in making their pursuit heard, making their pursuit understood, all right? Before I proceed any further, Sinvin, do I transfer the host back to you or we continue?
No, it continue.
Continue, right? Yeah. Okay. All right, so moving on. So this is something that I affirm myself. Okay, this is one of my poems that was a part of the Rinpa Book of Records, anthology, and this is an affirmation that I did myself. you know, because every day there is somebody out there trying to silence your voice, especially because you're a woman, and more so because you're a woman voice, you know. It's very difficult for the world to digest women speaking out loud. I was very lucky that most places that I have been a part of, especially as a professional capacity, people have been quite unbiased. But I can't say the same of the society at large. So this is something that I tell myself on an everyday basis. Right? Every day I talk about, when I talk about my art, I affirm. I give this affirmation to myself, right? Because every day we choose to live, okay? I won't bore you by reading it a little further, so I will go ahead with what we have to do. Okay, can you all switch on our videos, those of us who can, please? At least a few faces that I can see would be great. Okay? Except for Professor Neville, nobody else seems to be willing to do that. Come on, there are so many young people I see. There is Kartika, there is Arun, Daisy. Come on, let's see a couple of faces. Young stalwarts of the language, don't be hesitant. All right, I'll leave you to that. What I need you to do is this. Okay, I want you to respond. Are the participants allowed to unmute themselves?
Yes, they are. The option is being given to them. Okay. They can unmute and switch on the cameras.
Okay, great. Okay. So, okay, so this is what I want you to do, students. Do you have a pen and a pen and a paper, all of you?
Yes, ma'am.
Nice, thank you. Okay, thanks, Aaron. Thank you, Kartika. Okay, right. So this is what I want you to do. I want you to draw a flower called magnolia. Okay, instruction is very clear. I want you to draw a flower called magnolia. Take a minute or two and draw a flower called magnolia. No questions? No doubt, I want you to draw this flower. Okay, let's see. The teacher can give it a go as well. I mean, there's no restriction. We are talking about creative pursuits after. Shall we draw this flower? I'm hoping that y'all are doing what I've asked y'all to do. Another minute and we stop. Okay, I think that's enough time. Is there anyone who's completed drawing? Anyone who's completed drawing? Don't worry, I won't ask you to talk. You can just show me your drawing, that's good enough. You don't have to talk much. You can just show me. Anyone? Quickly, can the teachers out there help me to get some response from our students?
I think it's like just starting for them, right? Might be there. It's okay. Don't worry. You don't get less marks or more marks. It's still the same. We are still artistic. Guys, anyone completed?
You don't have to worry about it because I'm going to show you something that I drew. Yeah. So I'm going to show you something that I drew when they asked me to do this exercise, okay? And then you will have all the confidence in the world to share what you have drawn. Can you see this? Okay, sorry, give me a second. So I'm going to share something that I do that will give you the confidence enough to share what you have done. Okay. This is very blurry as it's blurred. Let's not have a background for a minute. There we go. And I'm going to show this, okay? It's not the best thing to do, but I'm going to do it anyway. Can you see this thing called flower that I have drawn?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, yeah, ma'am.
So it's that bad, okay? So you're talking to an artist of that caliber, right? So you all shouldn't be hesitant to. You shouldn't be hesitant to share what you've drawn. Come on. Let's have one or two of you share what you've drawn. I could call out names and be the mean person, you see. Let's see. Is Aishwarya here? Ah, Vinaya, ma'am.
I've drawn this.
One second. Oh, wow. That's cute. That's really nice. I mean, at least you have the petals in place. I'm like, Aaron has also shown me a beautiful flower. Let's see. Thank you, Aaron. That's nice. Ah, I like the way the petal, you know, folds. Very nicely done. Thanks, Aaron. Okay. Yes. Who else can we look at? Kartika is trying to show us the video. Oh, that's nice. That's cute. Okay. I like the fact that all of you all have thought of it with the leaf, you know. It's really nice. Anybody else would like to share what they've drawn? Okay. Very good. Okay. So now I'm going to ask you to talk. Okay. Not the people who showed me the flower, not necessary. Anybody who wants to, you know, discuss this, anybody who wants to talk about this can. My question is, what did you think when you saw this slide first? When I asked you to draw a flower called a magnolia, what did you think?
Ma'am, I thought there is that I is just added there.
You just added, I just added I, okay. You thought I just added the I because it was? What is the
because the other than that, it's magnolia. Called magnolia.
Yes, yes, you're right, Aaron. Okay. So you thought the I was added there. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
What did you think when you saw this question? Draw, I mean, when you saw this activity on screen?
Ma'am, maybe most of us have not heard or seen this flower. So,
sorry?
You know, we don't even know if it's a real flower or not. So, just imagine what's coming into your mind and just draw that. That's what you meant by asking us to draw this.
Okay. So you thought that it has something to do with imagination because most of you have not seen this. So I think it's a brilliant answer. Okay, great. Fine. Anybody else want to say this? Say anything about this? Okay. So I guess you pretty much got an idea of it, right? When I asked you to draw a flower called a magnolia, this is not a name we've heard. This is not you know, something that is common. It seems a little absurd even that, you know, that you would give a name like this, which is absurd. This looks like a disambiguation of the word magnolia. And why is he asking you to draw this flower? Interestingly, what if I tell you that poetry is exactly like this? You know, poetry is like drawing this imaginary flower called a magnolia. When Kartika showed me her work, when Aaron showed me his work, and when Vinaya showed me her work, I think that every flower was a magnolia. Because for you, this is a magnolia. Are you getting what I'm saying? in your perspective, from your eyes, in your point of view, this is Magnolia. Okay, so a poem also is very much like this. A poem is like this imaginary flower made in Magnolia, because a poem is simply what you think a poem is. There is no specific rule. There is no specific yardstick that says this is a poem and this is not. Okay. So I don't know if you all remember, but when the Vice President of the United States, Kamala Harris, took her oath, there was a young girl who read her poem out. And then there were a lot of criticisms about her the literary world, saying, what kind of a poem is this? I mean, this is not a great poem. A poem should have structure. This is merely an attention-seeking thing, so on and so forth. But my question is, who are we to judge? Who are we to judge and say that this is a poem and this is not? That this works and this does not, right? So I want you young people to remember that whenever you're writing, what you write is what you write. Nobody defines it for you. There's no right or wrong poem. There's no right or wrong creative. The fact that it is creative, the fact that you have created it, is all that matters. Right? So if you keep that in mind, then it becomes a lot more easier for you to navigate through the choppy waters of getting your work published. It has to be good for you. It has to do something to you. Right? The second it does something to you, it becomes further useful for the world to read and benefit from it. Okay? All right, so let's move on that note. A quick activity for all of you, okay? I'm hoping that this will garner better response than the previous one. What I want you to do is I want you to go to this website called as menti.com. Is it clear on the screen to all of you?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, great. So I want you to go to this website called menti.com. And you will see a page that pops up and asks you for this password. I want you to type this password there, okay? 351110958. I want you to type this password into menti.com. The second you do that, you'll have made note of this, right? Menti.com. The second you do that, there will be a pop-up that you will get, a question that you will get on your screen. Okay, I'm hoping you all are doing what I asked you to. Everybody is able to access it. I'll show that again to you. Please go to menti.com, menti.com, and type the password 351110958. The second you do that, there is a certain question that will pop up, a page that will pop up. I want you to respond to that question in your own words. I'm hoping you're able to access that page.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so this is what you should be able to see when you go to that page. Okay. And by now I should have got some responses. You can type the answer to this question. What comes to your mind when you hear the word creativity? You all are on your phones, right? So you should be able to access the site. because productivity, art, imagination, wonderful. Any more responses? Come on, 27 of you on the meeting. And I get only one response. It's very sad. Come on, quickly, quickly. Let's see some more responses. Interesting, creativity is interesting, okay. Cinema, very nice. Animation, very good. What else do you think is creativity? What comes to your mind when you hear the word creativity? Okay, designing, very good. You can give more than one response. You can give up to three responses to the question. Animation is silence. That's a beautiful answer. Silence is a wonderful answer. Uniqueness, great, yes. Myself, also a great answer. So silence, art, productivity, imagination, animation. Did someone say emptiness? Wow, okay. That's really creative students, yeah? I didn't think of these answers when I thought of creativity. This is very good. Emptiness, that's a very interesting answer as well. Okay, any more responses? Artists, okay. Artists, stretching our mind, okay. I'm sure you mean to say expansion of the mind. Great, okay. A few more responses and then we'll move ahead. Okay, I suppose we'll get back to this a little later. So look at the responses that you all share. You know, that's wonderful, wonderful responses that you all have shared. And what are these responses? These responses are silence, uniqueness, myself, emptiness, animation. Can I ask who said silence?
That's me.
Yes?
Yeah, I'm sorry, something what?
There's somebody who responded as silence. Creativity is silence. So I just wanted to check who that was.
That is myself. Okay. Here in the bill.
All right. Okay, fine. Good.
Yeah, because I can write poetry only when I'm in, you know, just
when you're quiet. Okay, great. Interesting. Somebody said myself. All right. So these make for very great responses, students, because I think that all of us have a way of dealing with creativity. Now, all these responses are so different. If you look at the responses, you will understand how each response is so varied from the other, right? If you look at the word imagination, if you look at the word art and artist, they are so different from the word silence. They are so different from the word designing. They're so different from the word cinema. Yet, creativity is the fact that it is individual. It's the fact that it is supposed to be related to the individual who is creating this. Okay, so remember that creativity is an individual process, a process that that demands a lot of passion, a process that consumes a lot of your individual personality. All right. So let me tell you a little bit. We are talking about the journey of a poet. So this is a favorite quote of mine as a poet. W.H. Auden says, poetry makes nothing happen. Poetry simply is. You know, poetry makes nothing happen. There's nothing that poetry can do. It doesn't make anything. It doesn't shake the world. It doesn't, you know, make someone the president. It doesn't burn books. It doesn't, it doesn't cause a revolution. It doesn't kill corona. No, poetry does not do anything. Poetry makes nothing happen. Does this mean that poetry is useless? Not at all. This means just the opposite. Poetry makes nothing happen, yet poetry is happening. Poetry makes nothing happen, yet poetry causes things to move in a particular direction. It inspires a certain motion and passion. Right? Which is why this becomes one of my favorite quotes of all. I remember as a young person when I used to, I used to write poetry. I think one of the worst things that anybody can do is to write poetry and give it to your English teacher. It's because the English teacher sometimes cannot value a young person's poetry for what it is. We tend to look at the poetry so critically. We tend to look at the rhyme, the meter, the way it's written, the language, the grammar. Sometimes we fail to recognize the thought and the emotion behind English poetry. Yet that's the only outlet we have, right? You can only go to an English teacher with English poetry, right? So I remember the time that I first went to my teacher with my poetry, and he asked me, why are you showing me this? I said, Mr. Thor wanted to see it. He said, no, why are you showing me this? And I kept saying, no, because I want you to see it. And he told me something very interesting that I will never forget. And that really, really made a big difference in my journey as a poet. He said, Tanya, you're giving it to me because I will validate your feeling. I will tell you it is very good and I will appreciate it. You want that appreciation, you want that attention, which is why you're showing me your poetry. As a young girl, it hurt me a lot when my teacher said that. But looking back at it today, I thank her for having said that to me. Because if she hadn't told that, then I wouldn't have written poetry for myself. I would have constantly been trying to write poetry for somebody else. Isn't it? So how many of us tend to write poetry or do something creative for the sake of someone else, for the sake of an audience? We pray to the choir, isn't it? So for us, it becomes important. This validation becomes very important. This is why today we see this thriving community of Instagram poets, thriving community of Facebook poets, thriving community of poets on Twitter, right? We see this because they have immediate validation. Right? They get instant validation for what they do, instant gratification for their work. Unfortunately, poetry works in slow and silent ways, which is why I was very inspired by what Kinnibin said, that silence is what comes to my mind when I say creativity. Right? Great things happen in silence. Okay, so it's important for us to remember that we write not to impress anybody, not to get validation from somebody, we write because we write. Right. And this is how my first book opened. And this is the thought with which I opened my first book and I published my first book. I recounted an incident that I had with my niece. You know, my young niece, she was, of course, she's a grown-up girl now and she's looking at taking on the world. She's just finishing her 10th and wants to become great things in life. But back then, she was a six-year-old kid, you know, and she used to love sitting and doing stuff with me. And one of those afternoons, sitting and sketching something, painting something. And I was sitting and, all English teachers do, sitting and reading a book. We have this thing, right, that we have to be reading a book all the time. Sitting and reading a book. And then she suddenly looked at me and she said, Kitty, I love you, she said. And I said, okay, fine, thank you. Why do you love me? 6-year-old, no? And the adults are also so stupid. If a kid gives you a compliment, it's a sort of basic. You don't really ask questions. But then we are adults, we need validation. No? We need that appreciation. Oh, you're so great, you're so wonderful. So I don't think a kid is going to say something like that you buy me chocolates, you buy me this, you this, that. But the kid said something so prolific. You know, it is a philosophy. It is something that philosophers shouldn't say themselves. He said, I love you because I love you. No reason. I love you because I love you. Saying, yeah, this is what poetry is. Poetry simply is. You write poetry because you write poetry. There is no reason behind poetry. There is no explanation behind poetry. There is no need for any, any validation or marker for poetry. That, right? So what that kid knew at that age when she was six, a six-year-old knew, unfortunately, the others and adults don't understand. Right? So write for the sake of writing. Right? Poetry is it's the reason itself. There is no reason for you to separately write poetry. Poetry simply is. So this is one of the other poems that I wrote about that topic, saying, a poem simply is. A poem neither cries nor laments, the year that you read your mind, not as it passed on with the current, but here a mindless hijack. A poem simply is, like a lover's smile after bitterly farewell. Or a breeze that gently blows, like a simple bird hidden within a feature, or a scattered book that flows. A poem simply is. The love between birth and new is like those subtle moments in time that choose to neither agree nor refute the reasonlessness of mind. A poem simply is. That's what a poem is. A poem does not need a reason, it does not need a season, it does not need anything. Which is why I make one of my most famous statements. A lot of my students, a lot of my readers remember me for this statement, saying everyone writes a poem. It's the persistent ones become poets. Everyone writes a poem, the persistent ones become poets. You keep at it, you keep engaging with it, you keep talking to your work, you become a poet. Right? Because everyone writes a poem. Somewhere, you would have, everyone, think of it, everyone at some point in life would have written a poem. They're just too coy to admit it, right? So what is the poet's mind? The poet's mind is rooted in context, but it's free in content, right? So for example, if I'm sitting here and there is the pandemic all over us, it's impossible for me as a poet not to be affected by that context. Okay, but that does not mean that my content should clearly talk about corona. My content could talk about isolation, it could talk about fear, it could talk about solitude, it could talk about the difficulty of being stuck inside a home which you don't like. It could talk about the lack of a roof, it could talk about the loss of employment, anything. But it is related to that context, it's rooted in that context. But the content is not directly connected. So the poet's mind is always rooted in context, but free in content. And the poet views the world as it could be, not as it is or as it was, as it could be. The poet is always a dreamer. And there's a famous poet called Jayakanthan in Tamil, a famous writer and poet in Tamil called Jayakanthan. And Jayakanthan used to always say that a person who does not have hope should not write poetry. You know, a person who does not have hope should not write poetry. A person should have certain confidence in life, otherwise it's not right. And I think it's true because poets are dreamers. Poets are people who look at the world as it could be, right? Because the entire world is the poet's home, right? For the poet's imagination, the world is a far, far better place than it is right now. And it is with this thought, with this idea that the poet writes, and therefore it becomes himself. And ultimately, everything begins and ends with the poet's thought. This is something that continues to flow, right? I want to skip a couple of things that I want to talk for want of time, but I want to talk about why poetry, you know, why should we pay attention to poetry so much? And what is the greatness about poetry that so many people are pursuing it today, right? The first and foremost thing is deep. I'm sure you all are English students and you all are familiar with this term. Deep is that it is representative of time, right? It showcases what the time it is written in is. For example, the poem London by William Blake. He says, I wandered through each chartered street, you know, where the chartered trains have flow. Right? He's not talking about wide streets and beautiful London and, royal streets. No, he's saying chartered streets, which means every street is divided into pieces, right? And Thames is flowing in a chartered way, right? It is broken, it is fragmented. And chartered also could mean bound by rules, bound by societal norms, right? So he's saying, you know where the chartered things just flow. So I'm watching London, which is deteriorating, which is not the same. So here the poet is telling us that London at the time that he wrote this particular poem was a chartered place, which is bound by rules. It is a place that was broken, a place that was fragmented, right? So it represents the time so effectively. What poetry also does is that it holds deep intellectual and philosophical value. Every time you are demotivated, every time you are low, I'm sure there is a song, there is a particular poem, there is a particular piece of art that inspires you to come back to that successful nature, inspirational, right? A lot of us have grown up listening to songs that motivated us, right? I'm sure my colleagues here will agree that as kids of 90s and 80s, we used to listening to those wonderful philosophical numbers in various regional languages to sort of inspire us to take on life, right? Look at what H.W. Longfellow says in his Psalm of Life. He says, "Dust thou art, to dust returneth. It was not spoken of the soul," he says, right? The fact that you are dust is not a comment about the soul. It's a comment about the body. It's an inspiration. It has philosophical value and it's deep. And what does it do? It reveals the innermost feelings of the poet. It's cathartic. Right? It's innermost feelings, right? So here is Ernst Dawson, who's talking about his love, Cynara. And he's saying, "I cried for madder music and for stronger wine, but when the feast is finished and the lamp is fire, then falls thy shadow, Cynara, the night is bent." Okay. Every day I try to forget you. Every morning I try to forget you. I lose myself in loud music, stronger alcohol. But when the feast is finished and the lights are out, the night belongs to you. I can't help but think of you. Innermost feelings in the poet, you know. And I'm desolate and sick of an old passion. Hungry to the lips of my desire. I have been faithful to the time that I am. Right? So this is the innermost feeling of the poet. Deepest. And it's cathartic. Right? You all must have read an introduction by Kamala Das. He says, you know, don't call me Kamala. Call me Bhadaripudi. Right? This is what she says. She says, "I don't want to be labeled. You ask me why I write in English. I will write in whatever language I want to write. I got so tired that I started wearing my brother's shirt," she says. Right? So this cathartic, she's letting out these deep feelings that she's having. Right? So it is cathartic. And then, of course, poetry has certain qualities that make it a great poem. Of course, all poems written are great to make her to the creator. But Ezra Pound points out these three particular aspects of poetry that are great. You know, he talks about how poetry is music making or melody making. It should be poetic. Okay? When you're listening to certain poems, you're inspired, isn't it? You're inspired in a way that, you know, it doesn't leave you, you know? Right? So she says, melopoeia, which is music making or melody making. She says, we use words in such a manner that it invokes the rhythm of sensation within the reader or the listener. And then she says, it creates a visual sensation, right? Panopoeia, which is making images. It is revelatory, showcases images, right? So we see Wordsworth saying, you know, they toss their heads in a sprightly dance, 10,000 saw I at a glance. Isn't it? He's talking about the daffodils. He's creating a visual. He's making a visual. All right. So she says that it is evoking a certain visual sensation within the reader. And then, of course, it's the logopoeia. It's creative with language. Okay. It invokes feelings through images or prosody. And this invocation of emotion is key to poetry. If poetry cannot invoke emotion, then it is probably, you know, it probably has a long way to walk, long way to go, right? I mean, look at something as simple as, My Fair Lady. My Fair Lady, and he's trying to talk about, trying to teach English to this girl. It is rain and pain for me and in the plain. There is a certain rhythmic, there is an assonance, there is a consonant of words here, right? And some memorable lines that will never leave us, right? Where we see poets saying things that invoke this emotion in us, right? When, I mean, how many of us would have quoted "Buddha lovely, dark and deep, but I have my trumpet to keep and my race to over poetry"? How many of us would have said, "We love with a love that is more than love"? How many of us would have said, "Lost is the country with all and all but forgotten"? So this is a sense of retention that only poetry is capable of, right? It is memorable because of its assonance, because of its quality of sound, right? So a lot of people have misunderstood poetry and it has changed over the years. It has evolved over the years, right? The themes have evolved in tandem with whatever cultural attributes are happening at that point, right? So we have spoken, poetry has spoken to us about borders, about culture, about politics, ethnicity, language, literature, so on and so forth. So we'll take a quick look at what kind of themes poetry deals with. So when we look at pre-independence, we saw it as nation and patriotism. Then it was followed by identity, followed by, you know, various experiments. And then we spoke about philosophy. And then moving on, the 90s was the time when young women were writing, you know, relationships were important, love was important. 2000, we heard people talking about loss of natural habitat, gender, religion, LGBTQ poetry became such a big rage in 2000, right? 2010 moves us towards self-identity crisis, it moves towards gender conflict, race. And now we are in 2020, we have directly moved on to Instagram, we've directly moved on to social media, right? So there is a sense of, you know, there is a sense of urgency today for us to sort of achieve a certain end to poetry, right? So if you look at some of the Instagram poets, you look at Atticus, if you look at Tom Scriber or Ruthie Kaur or Sarah Kay, spoken word poets, the Facebook poetry, everything has a certain, you know, certain sense of urgency to it. But I think it's the calling of the time. We can't say that it is good or bad. It is something that is happening and we have to accept it. And therefore, this generation understands that poetry is beyond rhyming. It reflects instant gratification. It reflects disintegration of structure. And then it talks about performance versus leadership, right? So poetry over the years has evolved into, you know, evolved into an entity which has served the cause of many, whether subtly or the evidently is left to the person who's inquiring into it. But poetry may not live, but it does survive. It outlasts its makers and acts as a voice beyond it. And though a poem doesn't make things happen, it happens every time someone does. Thank you so much for paying attention to me. I know it hasn't been one of the greatest things to do to come on a Friday afternoon to sit and listen to a poet, but I think it's been wonderful interaction with you all on this forum. If you all have any questions, if you all have anything particular to ask, if you all have anything particular to say, if you all have any poetry that you want to share, you're most welcome to do that. And before I forget, I want to tell you that the Bangalore Poetry Circle, which is a poetry group that I curate every month, we meet every second Saturday or third Saturday of the month. The meetings are happening online as of now, so all of you who are interested in reading a poem, listening to poetry, you are most welcome to participate. I will share the invites with your professors. They will in turn share it with you all, and you're most welcome to come to the open mic and read your poems, participate, get your poetry published, so on and so forth. Thank you again.
Thank you. And students, the forum is open for questions. If you have anything, please go ahead. And yeah, like in my class, there is no right or wrong answers. You can just say whatever comes to your mind. So go ahead and ask. It's your forum now. Yeah, and I've given the option to unmute yourself. So yes, you can unmute and go ahead and anything and any questions, you can go ahead and ask. Yeah, and she's an English professor too, so you can even clear your doubts. So no problem.
Also, if you all want to speak in any other language, also you're welcome to. I can understand Malayalam to a great extent. I can speak Malayalam to a good extent as well. So please don't be, don't hesitate to speak in English. I know I used to hesitate a lot because growing up, my English wasn't great and it took me a while. This is something that I ask my students also to do. So if you want to speak in another language, please do. This is not an English classroom. This is an interactive forum. So if you want to speak in another language, please do. Ask your questions. I'm more than happy to answer.
So you can type it in the chat box.
So is the chat disabled?
No, I don't think the chat is disabled. Yeah, the option is being opened up. Yes, I've given the option to chat directly.
These are the Insta handles in case you all want to follow and you want to share your poetry with us. If you want us to interact with you, we'll be more than happy to do it. Professor Nibin, in case you don't have any questions, then probably yes. You could wind up.
Perfect. Sister Juliet, she's our HOD. So, sister, over to you, sister.
So, Ms. Sharanya, we are glad to have you with us. We are privileged. We are privileged to listen to you, a great poet and a great learner, scholar, researcher, I feel. I thank our Nibin for having such a great friend so that we could also experience the value of that resource. You are a great reservoir for us. Thank you very much. I was really admiring the PPT you have presented and shared with us. So some of the beautiful things, I'm talking on behalf of my students too. Maybe, you know, what you were speaking, what you spoke about, like, you know, poetry. What is poetry? The love between verse and muse. Something very beautiful. So it is maybe I could sit and meditate on it for hours and days. It's really wonderful. So similarly, many other definition you have just displayed before us. Thank you.
Thank the network. I think sister's network has gone down, I suppose. The sister is in the convent, so I think sometimes. It's the weather is bad, so that's one of the great concerns too.
Sister Julie, thank you so much for those lovely words, because for me it is so important to be able to reach out to people with these thoughts. I'm so glad that you all have been benevolent enough to allow me to be a part of this forum. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for your kind words.
Thank you, Sharanya, and coming over and, you know, sharing those valuable inputs. And yes, we would have many more, catching up to do with our students. And I did get a lot of personal messages with students. They really liked it, and I'm happy they could bring it. And good, at least if I can get some 2 to 3 poets out of this group, it would be much good. And they could come out and they will surely cherish what they have in them. Thanks a lot, and thank you for sharing your viewpoints and thoughts. Thank you, Sharanya.
Absolutely. And anytime you want to interact on poetry.
I think sister is back. Sister, you had anything to say, sister? I'm sorry, I had to interrupt because the network had gone down, sister. Sister, you're on mute.
So, and another thing, what you explained was all world is a poet's home. Something much more exploring. Okay, it was really beautiful. And then I felt that you were displaying a pageantry of great poets before the students and before us, like William Blake, Ernest Dowson, Kamala Das. You have made a thorough study of all these poets and made a wonderful and awesome presentation for us. Then I was really taken up by the terminology you used and explained, melopoeia, Phanopoeia, Logopoeia, these are all, this would enrich our students, I would believe. And then you were talking about Insta poet and then soul scribbler, etc. Now, let me ask you, who are you? A great poet. I believe you are an in-depth scribbler. Okay. So thanks a lot for this beautiful talk given to us. And thank you. God bless you. Thank you, Nibin, on behalf of Darshana Ma'am and all the students. We express our thanks to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Sharanya. Thank you, sister. And thanks all. Thank you to all the students who have been part of this event today. Thank you, and have a safe and happy weekend.
Thank you.